Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. The planet Mars, our planetary neighbor and a source of enormous mystery for space science and academia. In our previous episode, our guest Ev Cochrane summarized some of the incredible identities given Mars in ancient myth, astronomical traditions, and religion. For reasons that defy explanation based on Mars's appearance and behavior in our sky today, Mars was globally recognized as a masculine warrior hero, the god of war, a dragon slayer. Cochrane also described the equally inexplicable, in modern astronomical terms, relationship between the quote, masculine Mars and the feminine Venus in ancient storytelling. For decades, Cochrane and his colleagues, including David Talbott and the late Dwardu Cardona, have worked to reconstruct the catastrophic celestial events that inspired countless global recurring patterns in myth and religion. As Cochrane explains in this conclusion, the reconstruction of these events has involved not merely a cross-cultural investigation of myth, but also sheds remarkable new light on the origins of words and language.
I've now had 40 years of experience reconstructing these myths, and it's becoming more and more apparent that not only are the myths all around the world, but comparative mythology works hand in hand with comparative linguistics or language. And so take whatever language you want, it doesn't make any difference. Those languages will always include archaic vestiges of these catastrophic events, and so words will mean things that have no reference whatsoever in the current natural world or the current sky. When you find that confirmed on virtually every continent, you get a level of confidence that suggests that we're on the right track, that's for sure. To take a classic example, we mentioned eclipses earlier. So the universal myth of the eclipse is that a sun-like object is swallowed by a great dragon, right? And of course, as you said, there are no such things as dragons. So what does that mean? And you will find that cultures all around the world will always say that was a time of tremendous terror, disaster, and that indigenous cultures all around, they always made a tremendous noise, like banging on drums or clashing shields together or shouting and screaming at the time of an eclipse. And their goal was, according to them, to scare away the dragon. None of that makes sense by current standards. I mean, we just had a full eclipse of the sun here in the last year or so, which was a spectacular event. But number one, there was no disaster. There was no loud clanging of sounds. The end of the world did not happen. And so as you start to piece these things together, you realize that these traditions surrounding eclipses have nothing to do with the current eclipse whatsoever. They have to do with a prototypical celestial disaster that was interpreted as a sun-like object being swallowed by a giant dragon. To give you another example, I think that uses a little bit of language that will make my point. The Sumerian word, again, Sumerians, theoretically the oldest language on the planet, started writing about 3000 BC. And in the Sumerian language, the word for sun is ud, but the Sumerian word for storm is also ud. Now, how is that to be explained? Why would a culture use the same word to describe a sun as they use to describe a storm? Well, if you pull up the earliest artworks in ancient Mesopotamia, you will see this picture of the sun will have a giant thunderbolt or lightning bolt right in its center. So slowly but surely, you start to deduce that the former sun was electrical in nature. And the former sun god was the thunder god. So turn to Greece, or take any culture, doesn't make any difference. If the same bizarre association of sun and storm will show up in other cultures as well, and also in other languages. So it's not just a wild guess about comparative mythology. This is comparative linguistics. And so that is a powerful argument that some historical event caused these bizarre associations in these various languages. The earliest pictures of the sun show a giant lightning bolt set right in the center of it. Dave and I had reconstructed that the center was where Mars was at. And so you get this image that Mars was at the center of an intense lightning storm. And so it was constantly being subjected to these unbelievably powerful exchanges of lightning, plasma, whatever you want to call it, unbelievable torsion of its geological structure. Again, the language also is going to describe that. So when you talk about early words for lightning bolt or thunderbolt, they will have the word star in there. So like you will have a word for thunderbolt is astropelike, for example. And there's dozens of words that I could cite just like that. But it clearly means star something. In that case, star axe. The original thunderbolt was a celestial star-caused event. That has never been discerned before or properly recognized as being at the heart of so much of comparative mythology. But it clearly testifies to the solar system having a radically different appearance in former times.
In 1971, when the Mariner 9 spacecraft returned the closest images of the Martian surface to that time, planetary scientists were astonished to observe the stupendous feature Valles Marineris, an enormous canyon system which is 4,000 kilometers long and reaches depths of up to 7 kilometers. If Mars was indeed drastically closer to planet Earth only several thousands of years ago in prehistory, then, as Ev explains, perhaps it's not a coincidence that a figure in myth and storytelling is the scar-faced warrior.
I don't think there's any doubt about it. The particular myth that Dave cited very early on, I can just read it to you. It's as describing this character named Scarface in North American myth, and it goes like this. He was so poor he had no clothes, not even moccasins to wear. He did not play with the other children because they made fun of him. He had a ridge scar on his face, and they called him Scarface. So as I mentioned earlier, when Mars was close to Venus, a long ways from Earth, it appeared small, like an infant at Venus's breast. But when it moved on its orbit towards the Earth, it grew giant in size. And so you get the impression that you could see a lot of the surface fixtures on Mars, kind of like we can see the structures on Moon right now. When we've got a full moon, you know, you'll see certain sections of a crater on the moon or whatever. But there's no doubt that Mars was much bigger than the moon. And when it got close to the Earth, if the scar was there, Valles Marineris, yes, I think that's a very strong possibility.
One of the great surprises in planetary science has been the discovery of Martian meteorites on planet Earth. While many mainstream astronomers initially challenged the validity of the discovery, Ev explains why Martian meteorites on our planet are both explicable and necessary in the catastrophes hypothesis.
When we first started discussing this subject in the mid-90s, Dave and I were on the internet trying to get some feedback from the scientists. We had a bunch of JPL scientists on there, the world's famous figures. Each and every one of them denied that meteorites could get off the planet Mars. They could not. They had no way that they could figure out how these giant rocks could get ejected off the planet Mars. But we had statements from ancient Sumerian texts and stuff saying meteorites come from the planet Mars. So we were pretty confident that not only did meteorites from Mars make it to Earth, but they make it to Earth in tremendous numbers. That just based upon our reading of myth. And so within about 5 years, very quickly, the scientists came up with this ejection hypothesis where they have some massive celestial object smash into Mars and eject each of these meteorites. And of course, they place it many, many millions of years ago. And these, we're supposed to imagine that these rocks have traveled around the solar system for countless millions of years, and then they just happen to make their way to Earth. Our theory, of course, argues that because of these tremendous exchanges of thunderbolts, the lightning, plasma, the torsion going on between Mars moving close orbit to Earth, that it just naturally follows that gargantuan amounts of Mars rocks were launched into the atmosphere. And because of the close proximity to the planet Earth, it follows that they fell in great numbers on the planet Earth, much higher numbers than would ever be expected from the mainstream theory. And at the same time now, you have a perfectly natural explanation for why Mars lost its water, why it lost its atmosphere. I mean, mainstream astronomers have no explanation for why Mars looks like it had tremendous oceans and flowing water, and yet there's no possibility of having water today because it's out in the middle of nowhere and it's frozen solid. But given our theory where Mars was right next to the Earth, it stands to reason that just like the Earth, it probably had water at some point in time, and it certainly had an atmosphere at some point in time. And according to our theory, of course, it's lost both here in the last 5 to 10,000 years as a result of these stupendous catastrophes.